Hello, today I'm going to show solutions to an overheating PC during MemTest. My motherboard is an ASRock A320M, which is probably the least well-specified board to claim support for Ryzen 5s. Allow me to summarise my previous video's results. I had run MemTest until the end of test 4. The start of my last video begins by showing an unexpected power down at 1 minute 10 into MemTest. As the next table will show, that is a long way from the 2 minutes 12 needed to complete 4 tests. Passing test 4 wasn't guaranteed, but I learned enough making the last video to be able to measure the time taken to complete test 4 throughout that video. As I say, it's not guaranteed with dual channel, 32GB, 3200MHz, DDR4 and a Ryzen 5. Downgrade any of those features and it would be fine. No, that's not strictly true. With a Ryzen 5, even running this RAM at slower speeds would cause a crash during MemTest. A crash in the same place, test 4. Sometimes it makes it a bit further. It depends on the day, the temperatures. We got through test 4 lots of ways in the last video. The tables here show the peak temperature observed on the suspected failing chip, the AKUK297, by the end of test 4. The gigabyte per second figure is what MemTest reported the RAM configuration to provide. As the times to complete tests demonstrate, the figures need reading with a pinch of salt. Those results were obtained 3 weeks ago. The temperatures then were about what they are today, 24 degrees indoors, 20 degrees outdoors. When I completed the last tests, I was so impressed by the difference a fan made, even just the incidental flow of air over the chip, that I immediately ordered fans. If heat was a problem for the 297, it would be a problem for the CPU VRM too. I bought a variety because I didn't know how I was going to fix them. There is one empty screw hole and one occupied one nearby. Otherwise I'd need to cable tie into a connecting loom. I bought from this store. The 40mm fans were about 90 pence each plus VAT. Two 40mm ones could cool the CPU VRM completely. But anyway, I ordered more crap. A heatsink, because that would make up for the active cooling by having some passive cooling in there instead or as well as. And also was going to need a bit of leftover heatsink material for the little 297. I got a 6 meter tall heatsink because the VRM needs to sink more heat than an SSD would do. I can't find it easily by searching, so I've copied from my older history. Supplier is Panda Cooler. It comes with a thermal pad, but these are inefficient both for heat transfer and adhesion. I was going to need a lot of glue for the little heatsink for the 297 because I didn't want that falling off. I've also located more adhesion points for it rather than the tiny chip, which is 2.5 by 2.5mm. It's tiny. Any heatsink will help a lot there. While these were in the paste, I made templates for the intricate area of CPU VRM. I started with glossy paper, which is easy to work with but not exactly durable. Corrugated card was unsuitable for cutting with scissors. When folding to cut out slots, the scissors leave the opposite side longer. Plus the corrugations crumple and are wasted under stress when worked at this scale. Serial packet card was where I got to. If I was really bored, I'd have cut out my credit card too. Take the template firmly in place, draw around it, and take it away to your metal workstation. Since I left 2 weeks between making the template and using it, I forgot it was asymmetrical. At least with the two fins, which I chopped off the whole length of the heatsink, I was able to prove to myself that I could preserve those two fins throughout the length in the central reservation. Two fins form a U-shaped profile, which vastly increases the rigidity when it comes to pressing it in place, which might be a little forceful given the tight fit I'm going for here. I rushed to cut once after measuring 3 times, and I cut it backwards. An upside down heatsink is not a heatsink. I ordered again. This is the final result. I was scrupulous to remove loose metal after cutting, which caused a few scratch marks. But isn't increasing surface area a good thing? We can see how close I got to cutting that second central fin. Immediately after buying my first, I regretted not getting one with more fins so that they would be closer together. The design of the VRM components here isn't unique. I've seen this on at least B450 boards. Here's the mini heatsink for the 297, two fins wide, 8mm long. I could afford as an angle to get more of an overhang, but I'm anxious it doesn't fall off. And even good motherboards don't heatsink this component. They just use better chips to begin with. To test the heatsink, I fired up Prime 95. It gets to 90 degrees and stays there, with each core completing 36 tasks of the small FFT variety within the 30 minutes. Except one core, sometimes, which Windows will allocate housework to, no matter what I tell it. I leave it for 30 minutes because the first couple of cycles take disproportionately longer, so in 3 minutes you'll likely only have 2 tasks completed per core. I filmed this the night before fitting my new heatsink. I cut the thermal pads to 4mm by 5mm. This was the first time I'd fitted thermal pads. They have absolutely no adhesion. I thought they might be old, which they were, but the ones provided with the heatsink were the same. Fitting them was tedious and fiddly. I used a lot of adhesive and wasn't worried about it having any electrical conductivity. The whole point of these pads was to raise the heatsink from the other SMDs it passes over, as direct contact would create a short. Here you can see how much the pads have raised the heatsink. 1mm is a lot when you're looking at 6mm. The SMDs are under 1mm tall. I left the glue to dry overnight and reran Prime 95 in the morning, which wasn't a good idea, as I didn't increase surface area by adding pads, but merely cut the chips off from cool air. I dabbed more glue onto the pads, and the chokes, fitted the heatsink and gave it all of 10 minutes before testing with Prime 95. I'm hoping the pressure of the friction fit is holding it firm, and the heat accelerates the drying time. I present the results side by side with the previous evening's run. We join the tests 3 minutes in as temperatures approach their maximums. I'm speeding this up 10 times to take the new heatsink through 20 minutes of Prime 95. To summarise, peak temperatures are well down, but they are also shielded by the heatsink. With care, it can be seen that surrounding temperatures are all down a good few degrees. The same shift translates to the core FET components sourcing all the heat. I had one Ryzen 5 that was causing Windows to warn about corruption and shut stuff down for me, intermittently. Bent pins weren't warning enough, and I had to resort to Prime 95 stress testing to justify a return. Watch the rest, or skip ahead, or I'll attempt MemTest with the new heatsink. Welcome back. I'm recording my BIOS settings before I start MemTest. I had been using 1.1 volts for DRAM, swearing my DRAM was the golden ticket in a silicon lottery. I still like to overclock it, but I did get one small freeze at 1.1 volts. Despite it passing hours and hours of MemTest in single stick mode, as well as in dual channel using the old Ryzen 3, 1.14 volts will generate more power and heat. But we're in a cool snap right now, so I'm hopeful that the heatsink will make more of a difference than the CPU VRM one. The 297 has the bigger temperature gradient. I nearly complete test 5, but seeing 90 degrees in the heatsink masks a more serious problem underneath, and the computer shuts down. I slot a fan in near to some mounting holes and repeat. This simple low-power, tiny fan reduces observed temperatures to less than 55 degrees. It passed the fourth test. It passed all the tests, including a second run of the fourth and fifth. It takes 40 minutes and 18 seconds to pass all the tests at 3200 MHz dual channel. I've taken a camera around the setup at several points to show, one, that the thermal camera is able to see around the fan, unlike the CPU, which doesn't appear to get hot at all. 2, the thermal imaging matches the captured MemTest display. 3, the other chips are past the 297's temperatures now. And finally, 4, I jiggle the fan positioning a few times. I want to be clear where it is. I don't jiggle it much, but I try for different angles. Maybe a draft underneath the board makes a difference, who knows. I filmed almost an hour proving the stability. I'll speed it right up now and only slow down where I take a handheld around the rig. These shots seem more for my benefit in syncing up the two video feeds later, but I'll leave them in as they add authenticity. I should have tried this exact fan without the heatsink. I know I only saw a few degrees improvement in the CPU VRM with heatsink, but I feel passive cooling has a synergy with this active cooling. Hey, feel free to skip or watch the end of the video. I'm shutting up now. We'll be right back. I'm going to try and overclock the Infinity Fabric and RAM though. So the result we just saw was 2 minutes 4 seconds to finish test 4. I've tabulated the summaries for reference. I only included one result from the previous set of tests, the previous video. The previous tests weren't well specified. I had a random 120mm case fan 15 centimeters away from the hotspot. The model of the fan today is 4010, 40mm by 10mm. It's a fairly random make, but I've already shown the seller's advert. Before adding any fan, we were on 97 degrees by test 4. Even the reported RAM speed was consistently less, like every degree, even pre-test mattered. I should make clear that the temperature readings differ, in that today we're reading the temperature of the heatsink glued to the chip. While we'd read 55 degrees, behind the heatsink it's probably 65. I'm going to speed up the tests at 3466, 3666, and 3600 MHz RAM speed. Despite MemTest reporting higher speeds and lower latencies, the times of complete test 4 was the same in every case, 2 minutes 4. Higher speeds only require more voltage and produced more heat. That must mean something to execution speed. I've got a few measurements to back up what that meant. They're not comprehensive, but I don't feel like running all the tests, all those configurations again, and I just don't have the video space that anyone would be interested in. The measurements I've got are for the 6th and sometimes 7th test. 7th test takes a long time. It was 4 minutes 59 and 10:46 respectively for 3200 MHz. For 3466 MHz, it was 4:53 and 10:35. So you do have that improvement after the 6th test, and again after the 7th, if you're prepared to wait for the 7th, it doubles your time. And for 3600 MHz, I got to the end of test 6 in 4 minutes 45. I'm only showing to the end of test 4 to save time. I'm cutting out where I change speed and voltage in BIOS. I'm just leaving in the verification of the speed and voltage before booting to MemTest stick. I'm also cutting out where a MemTest has failed just because of the aggressive undervolting and overclocking. I've just had to increase the voltage a few hundred millivolts where that's happened. I'm always under the stock voltage. So there's plenty of scope to overclock if there was any point, but as we've seen with the time to complete test 4, there isn't much point to overclock the RAM beyond 3200 MHz, which isn't overclocking. It's just bringing it up to stock speed. We've seen improvements then, but you don't get improvements for overclocking, not for that test at least. You know, on others, but it's an unrealistic workload. It's not really worth the extra heat. And tests after the 4th continue to add heat. Passing test 4 is just a good indicator of stability. My room temperature is 24 degrees today, just like yesterday. Thanks.